what is a programming language? Which we shorten to what is a language, because we are programmers, so there is no other sort of actual language. Now, the first thing I'm going to ask you is, what do you think makes up a language? So, first of all, you are used to considering a language, I would wager, as a process. Right? It's something dynamic. It does not really exist like a chair exists, right? A language is something you use to express dynamic processes. But is a language also a thing or not? I do want to hear your opinion.
Not a physical thing.
It's not a physical thing, but it is a thing.
Yes.
Okay. So yes, anything that exists, we might say, is anything that has ontological validity is a thing. So a thing. Good. Now, is there a chair? Does it have? Well, it obviously has properties. Like I can sit on it. And what would be the equivalent in a programming language?
You can't sit on a programming language.
You can't sit on a programming language, yes. Very good, very good. What can you do with it?
You can write with it.
You can write with it. What can you write?
Code. Program.
Code, program. So there are programming languages that talk about emotion.
No, because emotion is irrational by default.
So, okay, so it is a thing we can program. Okay. What can we program in it then?
We can tell the computer what we want the computer to do.
Okay, so we can program.
It's an intermediate language between you and the computer.
So we can program the computer with it. Okay, nice. Good, good, good. Okay, so roughly this is what we do. Now, the question is, how is a programming language structured? Let's see, I'm going to write, turn around. It doesn't matter, yes, you can read it, but I would like us to together. So let's consider, what language, pick language.
F sharp.
So, let f of x is equal to, if x is greater than 0, then greater equal to 0, then x else minus x. What does this function do?
To a computer, this means nothing.
Well, it pretty much means something.
Only the F-sharp compiler understands.
Oh, it's the absolute value of x.
It's the absolute value of x, right? X is negative, then we turn it around. X is null or positive, then we just leave it back. Okay? So, this is a meaningful F-sharp program. So, it has a meaning, right? Which is the single thing we care the most about. And the meaning of this is compute absolute value of x.
That's the semantics.
This is what we call precisely the semantics. And it is a term I do strongly encourage you to write down. So this is the semantics. So the semantics is literally the description of what the language does, what a program in the language does. It is the dynamic interpretation of what the program means. Because this program will mean a computation, right? And it will mean a series of steps. If you think about how many things are going to happen in assembly to perform this, it's actually quite impressive. So, the point is, this program also represents one process that starts here, evaluates the if, then goes out here, potentially another process that goes here and exits here, right? And yet, what you do is you consider all the possible processes at the same time to come out with a uniform description of all the possible processes that this code is going to represent. All right? So the semantics of a language are the interpretation Well, how would you say it?
Algorithms?
They also can be nonsensical. They are an interpretation of what?
Whatever is written.
Of whatever is written, yes.
So the syntax.
Okay. So what does the semantic tell us about the program? So we have a program. We want to know what it
does.
What it does. So of what programs do? Is this well defined? Is the semantics well defined in the language? So, how many of you realize that this was the absolute value?
I did.
Mm-hmm. So, it is something that we can't really discuss about, right? Mm-hmm. So, the last bit of the course, which is perhaps that we build towards, is going to be in the precise and formal definition and implementation of the semantics of programming languages. Now, so this is the first bit. The second bit, the camera is taking us?
Yes.
Oh, so the notes then suddenly become slightly less relevant. Okay, now I'm going to forget about the semantics for a moment. This program here, what does it start as?
Come again?
How does this program begin?
With the left.
No, I mean far more trivially, on your computer. Where is this stored?
In memory.
Yeah, when you close your computer and it remains so that you find it tomorrow, where is it?
Hard disk.
Hard disk, in what form?
Digital and zeros.
Okay, let's go to something slightly more usable. Come on, guys!
F-sharp file.
It's an F-sharp file. Is that a binary file with a complex encoding?
No, it's a file with an extension that has fs on the end.
Yeah, and what's the content of the file? Text. This begins actually as a text file. Okay. It's a text file and blah blah blah. Eventually we have the semantics. Notice the lots of white space.
That means there's nothing that happens in between.
Of course.
Just draw a big magic box.
Yeah. Oh no. The cloud. Okay, so if I say, if I take the then away, and I write something else.
This is me.
This is being recorded.
I don't even care.
Yeah, you know what? For the future viewers, there's going to be penis jokes in the rest of the lectures.
Yeah.
or just edit it out after this.
No.
This is all going to stay.
It's essential for the learning process.
Well, you can also do it. Now, does this work?
No, not
in the F-sharp compiler.
Not in the F-sharp compiler, yes, of course. If anyone wants to go for the building a programming language...
I am going to make this a keyword.
And the meta compiler, it doesn't cost. Now, why does this not work?
Because the compiler doesn't understand it.
Yes, what is wrong? What does the compiler expect here?
It doesn't have any semantics for that syntax.
Yeah. Okay, so we are talking about syntax. So, the text file is read, and it has to conform to the syntax. So, there is a syntactic check. What is the syntax? So, the semantics we said was what? The description of?
What it does.
What the program does. Okay?
Syntaxes are symbols that are coupled to specified semantics.
Yes, that happens later. But the syntax itself, without the semantic. You could have a compiler that stops here. You could very well build a language that says, okay, this is a good file, thanks, and then it's done. It does nothing with it. Like an XML validator, for example. Okay? But so, what is the syntactic check? Forget about the rest of the language. Yes?
The keywords compared to what they do. You have keywords in the language, mm-hmm. and if they are implemented correctly.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the code you wrote was valid.
So the code you wrote was valid, okay. Yeah. Code written was valid, okay. Good. What does valid mean?
That after the penis operator, there comes the clause of the if statement.
Yes, Exactly, but in the specific case, considering this is F sharp, now a penis is not expected here.
So it will throw a syntax out.
Yes, what is expected here?
Yeah. Then.
A then. Oh, so this would give an error because a different keyword is expected, a different structure is expected. Why do we know that here we expect a then?
Because the if was specified.
Oh, because of the if. So wait a second. So come on.
As soon as it's read if, it checks for a condition. It finds a condition and then it looks for then. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't find then. It finds the penis. So he's going to throw a syntax error because he doesn't know where the body of the if starts.
So what you're saying is that the sequence of symbols has to respect a certain order, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So it was valid, and valid is that valid it means
that it conforms to the expected
proper order. Is it an order? So this was the corrected program. Is this correct?
No.
No. Order. It's fine, right? Yes. So it really seems to be a matter of ordering. Or is it?
Not just order, also use of certain keywords.
Check first the keyword, then check the order.
It also checks what you use, because if you use an int and use commas, then it doesn't work.
No, that's a type inference.
We get there. But so, wait a second. The thing you're saying, that first the keywords actually have to match. So you could do a first pass and immediately see if there is something wrong. Yeah. The keywords are malformed, or if you write 0,0 instead of 0.0, then the compiler can immediately tell you that the words are wrong, right?
Yeah.
So, first we have a check of the words, then we have the check of the sequence, right? Then we have a check of the sequence. Okay, now, is it a sequence, though? What I do want to ask you is, do you see a sequence? What is the proper data structure that you would use to represent this?
Tree.
He says a tree. How would you, do you agree? Or would you put this in an array, the whole program, in an array of symbols?
Do you both? That would be
something
the symbol
something.
Yeah, okay, yes, obviously. But if you do both, then it means that you have a hierarchical structure. If it is just strictly a sequence, you can't build a tree out of it.
Yeah.
This is the syntax for you, though.
So, he's talking about the tree.
Yeah.
But why is this a tree? What is the root of the tree? So this is a let, okay? So this is let. What is the content? Every tree can also have content. What content does it have?
It has an if statement with the condition. So
wait, that is the child.
No,
what would you say is the content of the let, the parameter of the let, like in a binary tree?
Function.
X, okay. So let has content X, but also?
F.
It is a let, and let has to carry what name the let has. It is a let that defines value of f. Is the equal needed here?
No. It's just a syntactic means that the body starts there.
The equal is just a way to tell the compiler, I'm done with the arguments, so now you get the body. How many children does the let have?
One child.
Two?
Who would?
Two or one?
One child with two children.
Oh, wait a second. So, you say two.
Yeah.
What are the two children of the left? The if and else.
Yeah.
Are they separate? Why can't we keep them together? Is it the same? Isn't it the same construct?
They use the same condition.
So they are based on the same condition. So
if there's a child that is a condition, and then two branches beneath that.
Yes. So you could say that the branches are actually just the two branches of the same if, right? So it's going to go to the right first because of space. So the child is if, and well, The if doesn't have any names associated to it, so I'm going to assume that all the information is stored as children of the if. How many children does the if have?
Two.
Okay, so who says three?
I'd say three, but if you don't know anything else, the condition has to be a child as well. Because you say that everything else about the if is stored as children, what is the condition?
Where is the condition? Yes, so we have three children. One is the condition. Yes? The second one is going to be?
If it's true.
What happens if it's true? So what?
The X.
The X, so the return value. So you see, this could also be a let. It doesn't matter. As long as it is just one child. So this is the X. Here we actually know it's going to be, well, not really an X. It's going to be something like a return node.
Which returns a boolean.
Which returns
a boolean.
Which returns X. Which is not a boolean. It's a I'm going to say return because this actually gives back the value to the function. Or we could even say this just says var X. Also be the same. So to assume the value of X.
Could you also make it so that the if has one child, which is the condition, and then the condition has two children, and depending on what the condition does, it throws.
No, because then if you do something like this, let B equals X greater or equal than zero, then this condition doesn't have any does not have the DNN as children. So you do really want, if you have a condition that happens in multiple places, then the number of children of the condition has to reflect all possible usages of conditions.
Okay.
So the if has condition, then else, but the condition doesn't have any children because the condition is an expression, it's just a value. So this is needed for space. Now, the next child of the if was?
If it's false.
If it's false, and, well, what kind of a node in the hierarchy is this?
It could just return the negative of var x. So you could just use a minus operator as a node.
Oh. Is it a minus of something?
It's a negate operator.
It's the negate of something.
Yeah.
So, negate. Neg. No, negate. And what is the child of negate?
X.
Var x. Right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we are simply putting brackets around things that go together.
Breaking everything down in blocks.
We are breaking everything down in blocks nested within each other. Wherever I put brackets, I could put anything else. I could even have here a declaration of a function that I then call. It doesn't matter, it is within brackets, so as long as it is one child. Now, this one is actually well, has to follow this idea as well. So what node is the condition?
Greater than equal.
It's a greater equal, yes. How many children does a greater equal have?
Two.
Two, and they are?
Left and right.
Yeah, left and right.
For x and zero.
For x. And the next one is going to be, how are we going to call it?
Zero.
Int zero.
Int zero, yes. I was actually going to go for const 0.
Const 0.
You know why?
It's always constant.
Because it's a constant.
Yeah. Why?
So we'll get the other end.
Const 0. This is... Oh, if I put the left here, then it is actually a proper 3 also visually. Let my parameters f and x. So, this here...
Is understandable for the
computer. Is understandable for the machine because it's actually storing information about how would you proceed to evaluate. So an interpreter, for example, given this thing, would actually be able, given a value of x stored somehow, it will go here and evaluate the let. Literally, it will say, okay, let's evaluate the let. Then it would check the if, would start at a condition, then it would decide whether or not to evaluate this branch or this branch. So going through the tree, is actually an interpreter. So can you roughly visualize this?
So with this system, you can write complex code and the machine will break it down to smaller blocks so it can build it.
It's not like the machine, you are going to have to write the parts. So the moment you decompose this into a hierarchy, the point of the hierarchy is that it allows you to make choices, like a binary tree search, for example. And here, you take the condition, you evaluate. So first you say, okay, I'm evaluating this. You evaluate the greater equal. You see what result we get. If it is true, then what do we evaluate?
X or X.
We don't know. It's just evaluation of the if that we would be building. So we would say, okay, now then return, evaluate the then branch and return whatever result. If the condition comes up false, we'll say, okay, well, we don't know. The point is, from the first, what the if knows is that it has a condition here named C, a then branch named T, and an else branch named E.
It's kind of retarded.
Yes, but that's the point. The if cannot possibly know all the possible bodies of the thens and the elses. So the if simply says, okay, to evaluate myself, I first ask the condition. Condition, evaluate yourself. Which is, and you should realize that this is going to be heavily re. Okay. Yeah, the R word is going to happen a lot. So,
yay. So, recursion. Recursion.
And recursion. You can't escape it. So, let's not go there.
That's a grim reminder. Okay, so basically, the syntactic check verifies that from the code we got, first we check the words, then we have the words, and we assemble the words into a hierarchy. Okay? Right?
Mm-hmm.
Good.
No, there goes the hierarchy. Anarchy now.
So, now, given the hierarchy, what if I said here else? Oh, sorry. Quote minus x. What's gonna happen?
Yeah.
What's gonna happen now?
Oh, everything's going tits up.
Type error.
We are gonna get a type error, says someone. What for type error would we get? What is the type of x? It's clearly an int. Why do we know it's an int?
Because in the condition it's specified.
Because greater equal than zero, you can only do against an integer, right? Doing so with something else would be unsafe. So in the then, in the first branch, when we return x, what is implicit then? That the whole if is going to return an int, right? So but then the compiler sees the other branch, and the other branch says that we return
the type string does not return. Does not match return type integer.
Exactly. Yes. So we get a type error. So this means that we have another kind of check. What are we going to call it?
String check.
Type check. So the next step is after the syntactic check, we have a type check. Does the program run in order to run the, to be able to perform type check?
No.
No, it doesn't, obviously. So we can do this at compile time. So actually the type checker is considered part of the syntactic check, because it is a way to check that the structure of what you wrote makes sense before writing. Okay, so what does the type checker do then?
Checks types.
He checks that the types follow what?
The rules.
What rules?
That you can't... that the return type of functions is...
Okay, I could say that I build my own language with the rule that here you can have an int, here you can have a string.
You can do that, but...
Can I? Yeah, okay, I can write that, but what's going to happen then in that language?
It's going to get errors when you try to get...
It's going to get errors? Oh, yes. So, ideally, what do we want the type checker to do for us?
Make sure we don't get
prevent errors when?
At runtime.
Prevent errors at runtime. Right? So, the goal of the type checker is to prevent Runtime errors.
Bridge exception.
Yeah. So basically, we kind of like to veer off from JavaScript. And preventing runtime errors means that whatever rules we choose for types, basically, what we want to say is it doesn't matter what branches we take or how much recursion, etc., the types make sense between all the possible branches. So if something can come from one branch or another branch, then the type that comes up is the same. So this is the most basic concept. Then we expect that, for example, the type of variable doesn't unexpectedly change. That would be embarrassing. Think about it. So after an if, then type of a variable changes, becomes a float.
Not mutable.
So we have a bunch of... So basically, prevent runtime errors means that we want the program to be well-behaved.
Yourself. Well-mannered, maybe.
Yes, but if you think about it, we can give actually a definition, which we will do later in the course, of what it means for a type system to be well-behaved. So there are actually some rules that have to be followed by a type system to guarantee a certain degree of safety. After the type checker, well, we are sure that there will be no runtime errors, which is already a good guarantee. So what we can do is we can directly build something that, given the tree, does what?
Build in intermediate language.
Okay, so this is the long route, actually. But this is the short route. What can you do immediately with the syntax tree?
Generate code. Because you broke down the blocks.
Do I need to generate code to run it?
You can run it.
Can I not just run it directly?
This language you have.
No, I mean, imagine that we've seen this in the previous course. You have an expression, you remember?
Mm-hmm.
We had type exp. An expression was const of int plus of exp, plus of exp times exp. Does this ring a bell?
Mm-hmm.
We built one of these, and what did we do with it?
We evaluated it.
How? What if we find plus of A and B? What do?
We evaluate A and we evaluate B.
And then?
We keep on doing that until it returns an integer.
No, if we have plus of A and B, then we evaluate A, we evaluate B, and what do we return?
The plus of A and B.
The sum of eval A plus eval B. This is known as an
evaluator.
evaluating.
I heard
inference.
It is an interpreter.
Almost.
An interpreter basically has a representation of the program that it checks explicitly. So it says, what is the next instruction? What is the next node in the tree? It checks what it is. It performs operations in memory, and it gives you the results. This is an interpreter. The alternative, which you should know very well, is come on, what does the Java thingy that you guys like do?
Crash.
Yes, and what does the virtual machine eat?
Bytecode.
Bytecode. Oh, so is there something that
compiler?
You do know what we're talking about. So we have a compiler. What does the compiler do? Into? Into? Is that strictly needed? Can I have a compiler that compiles into C?
Yes, you can.
So it translates. So it is a translator service. Translate source into target. What do we want target to be?
Runnable.
No.
Executable.
Yeah.
Into target. Which has to be executable. Right? So, and then does the compiler do anything else? What do we do then? So it translates the source into a target which is executable. And then? What does the compiler give us back?
Code.
Executable.
Gives us an executable. So it actually gives us the final executable file or logic or package, whatever. Whereas the interpreter actually takes always with us, well, we have to always take it with us, but it will give us directly the semantics of the program. Whereas the compiler gives us an executable file, and when you run it, you get the semantics of the program.
Yes.
Okay? This is what a language looks like. This is a language as a thing. A language is made up of a parser, which takes a stream of characters and translates that stream into an orderly hierarchy of syntactic elements. Then we run this hierarchy through the type checker. The type checker will either tell us, okay, go on, this is fine, you may run this, or it will tell us,
no, please don't.
There is an error. If you run this, you will get an error, so I'm not going to let you run it. Finally, we can take the result of the syntactic check. So ideally, you could build a language, a dubious language.
That always gives back no errors.
Yeah, exactly. What do we call this language?
Java.
No, Java actually is...
JavaScript.
JavaScript, yes. What's some other languages that do this?
Python.
Python, yes.
Python don't care.
Exactly. They do not care. JavaScript cares far less than Python.
Yeah, there is a button for strict mode.
Yeah, but I don't think the language likes it, actually. You could actually also skip the interpreter and do the same, and you have, I think it's C Python. No.
Yeah.
I think so. Yeah. Which compiles directly Python into C, but with the same semantics of Python, of course. So it doesn't do much type checking. Right?
There's so many errors.
Funny guys, you don't care.
Indeed. So,
the semantic check is done by the parser.
Semantic check? Is that a semantic check? What do you mean by semantic check?
It's done in the middle.
The syntactic check?
Syntactic.
The syntactic check is done by the parser, yes.
And what's the parser made of?
Code.
Preferably Git code, but sometimes Git code.
The language?
Okay, whatever you define.
Again, what was the question?
The parser, is it made of a language?
That is your choice. You can have, there do exist languages which are made to express parsers. There do exist languages that are made to express semantics of languages. These are known as metacompilers. That happens to be my personal
and
hobby.
Some people are lunatic and write their own.
Yes, exactly. You can write. There is a student of a first year student that is embarking on the quest to write a whole compiler in C. You can do it.
But the compiler has to be compiled as well.
Yes, of course. Then you use the compile. Oh, yes. So, oh, here's a fun one. Okay, so this is roughly the structure which I'm going to write slightly smaller. So, we have the sources, then we have the parser, then we have the type checker, then we have either the interpreter or the compiler. At the end of both, it's a bit of a diamond, we have the semantics. Okay? Good. Now, in what language do we write this thing? Let's say that we are building some language. It doesn't matter what language it is, it's a new language that we are, I don't know, designing, whatever. Okay? So the language we are building is the language L. Okay?
L for language.
Not
L sharp.
Well, what does the L stand for? Come on, take a guess.
Lunatic.
Yeah. Now, we have the language L, and we write the first compiler for L. Okay? Mm-hmm. So, we write L compiler alpha. The alpha of the L compiler. It doesn't support all the features of the language yet. And what do we write the L compiler in?
Whatever you want.
Or besides L.
Yeah.
You can choose whatever language you want.
Better.
Besides L. No, but why can't you write this compiler in L?
L doesn't you can't find something right.
Because L doesn't exist yet. Okay. So then we have an L compiler which maybe doesn't support all of L, or it's very slow. Okay? Or we could even write what's easier. Do you think it's easier to write a compiler or an interpreter?
Yes.
Is it easier to build a compiler compared to an interpreter?
Interpreter.
No.
Because interpreter you have to check and compiler you have to change.
I think interpreter is harder.
Interpreter is easier.
So who says an interpreter is easier? Who says a compiler is easier?
You say both.
Oh. Nah. So why would we expect the interpreter to be easier?
Because you take a shorter route.
But because because literally we take a shorter route. Because in the interpreter you have to go through the original code and then you have to produce other code, perhaps also optimize it, whatever. And the other code that you produce has to be the same semantics.
Compiler.
The compiler, yes, sorry. The compiler has to actually take the source language and give you the target language, and the target language that you produce has to be correct.
That is a nightmare.
And lots of mistakes happen here. So this is not trivial. Whereas the interpreter simply takes the source and it literally just writes what it does. Literally. So if you have something like assign a variable, then you take the variable in memory and you change its value. It is much easier to debug. But the interpreter is going to be much
slower.
It's going to be much slower because it's going to check for every instruction what instruction it is to be able to run it. Whereas the compiler already knows the instructions because you actually wrote them in the target file. So if it's easier and it's the alpha, who cares, right? We're going to build an interpreter for L. Yeah, because it's easier. So we build the L interpreter alpha. Okay? It's easier. Okay. Now, and this is built in what language?
C.
Whatever. An existing language.
C.
C.
Java.
Java.
JavaScript.
I'm going to say an existing language E. E stands for existing. Okay? And now, we could say, okay, but I'm building the language L because in my heart I believe it's the best language ever. So I build the compiler for L, and I build the final version, so omega, final version, whatever. We don't need a Greek letter for this. And we build the compiler for L in what language? Why? I don't like E. I'm building L because I don't like E.
So then we use the interpreter as well.
So what? Yeah, yes. So what do I write the compiler for L in?
L.
In L itself.
Exists.
Because now I have it. So now, and how do I run this?
With the target language.
With a.
So with the
interpreter.
So we run the compiler LC of L on the interpreter LE. Which is an alpha, so it's slow, but it doesn't matter. Obi, and what program, what is the first L program that we compile?
Hello world.
The interpreter.
No, not the interpreter, because this thing here, if I run the compiler of L.
The first thing you do is compiler.
The first thing I compile.
Is the compiler.
Is the compiler itself. So, this is literally a compiler, right? This is going to run the compiler, right? Because it's going to run the compiler on the interpreter, but so it runs the compiler. Okay, so this runs, probably slowly, the compiler. So a compiler takes us into what? a source. And the only source we have here is this. So we run this to compile LC of L.
And then you can just declare what if you want to learn interpreter to extend the language.
Yes.
At this point I just have a compiler for L, and then I can extend it to order, have fun. Mm-hmm. And I could build, I don't know, an interpreter for L in L itself. Because now I actually have and with this what I get, what is the result of this?
Insanity.
No, what is the result of this? Specifically.
Wait, can I
a compiler.
A language with interpreter and compiler.
A compiler?
For L.
No. Because that is forgotten, because I compiled that way.
To your target language.
To whatever the target language was. So a compiler for L in, I'm going to say, our assembly. Okay? In whatever HTML.
HTML.
It's not executable, but with CSS, yes. The point is, I now have a compiler for L in assembly. Okay, so this could also be quite complex, very optimized, it doesn't matter. First execution of the compiler, it's going to be slow, but it doesn't matter because we do it only once, we do it with the interpreter. Then what use do we have for the interpreter? None, we throw it away.
I will again.
But you have to start, you have to use E, an accessing language.
Yeah, here.
I was the first interpreter.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask.
It is a bit like Tron physics, you know?
How do you build the first one if you have to use an existing one? How do you do it?
It's like you throw a plank in the air, you jump on it, and you jump, and you have a piece of rope, you push it, pull it up.
Hey, for the jumping!
The magnetical of a car.
It had to work the first one in assembly.
The first one was written in machine code.
Yes,
the very first one was literally written in machine code.
How many years did that take?
The first languages were simpler. Yeah. Languages like Fortran in the 50s was.
And then you built Fortran on Fortran.
Exactly, and then they kept building on. It is also a historical consideration to realize that the first languages were assembly languages. So the first actually were machine languages. So the first proper compiled languages were assembly languages, where you got an easier way to express machine code. Then very low level languages like Fortran, where at least you could say a variable that which name begins with I think I is an integer variable, which was lots of help already. And then something like if, for example, if was not a construct, it's not a construct that machine understands. You have jump branch, so you don't really have an if and an else. You don't have really function puts or forts and whys.
If you make an if that is actually a jump,
yes.
No one will ever notice.
Yeah, exactly. So the point is, every language added a little bit. It is a very incremental process. It's very layered. So the first compilers were not monstrosities of compilers like C lang or GCC,
and
because they were compiler
far.
Yes,
and then it's C++. Cut in line. Cut to line.
Yeah. This process is actually known as bootstrapping. We bootstrap the compiler. So bootstrapping of the compiler of L. Okay? Good.
Stay great.
Wunderbar.
Could you pause the thing? Performance. So I'm assuming that you're talking about optimizing languages. So optimizing special scenarios.
Yes, so domain specific languages.
You have to get cult following.
Yes, exactly.
And because we're lazy.
Oh, laziness, I do like it. So this is performance of the PC.
Ease of use.
And now performance of the programmer.
Performance of the programmer, is that important?
Yeah.
Yes. Because if he saves time, you save money.
Okay.
Money.
Performance of programmer, so ease of use. minimizing errors, correctness. You could have a language which is slow.
Not 100% correct.
And You have to write lots of stuff, lots of information about what you expect code does, but which then is, well, I don't know, more often correct. Other stuff?
Compatibility.
Sorry?
Compatibility.
Compatibility, yes, yes, of course. Compatibility. So...
maintenance?
Maintenance, yes. And that, well, I'm gonna stop now. Because the list, how long does it go on?
Infinite. Goes on for miles and miles. Because
it goes for miles and miles because any attribute you have of a programming language
is made for a specific reason.
Yes, well, it has a specific scenario where you can use it. So you could have, I don't know, web applications, or you could have security. You could have a language where you can write code that has specific security problems. Like, I don't know, the language doesn't accept you to send an
or another special feature.
An unencrypted string, okay? So if you have a field like password, a type, password, P, if you don't run encrypt on P, then you can't send it on the network. Okay, so you could build a language with a type system that gives you a type error and says, password is not encrypted here, if the condition X, so you could have something like this.
Or you could build a language that stops intelligent people and says that it is an uncompilable code exception.
Couldn't you even build the language in such a way that if it's of type password, then it automatically encrypts P?
Yes, also, yes. Or exactly, you could say P.send, and you know then, you could even track information like after this line of code, what the language knows is that X greater than 0 implies that P is encrypted.
You are only limited to the bounds of logic.
That is actually a big issue, yes. What can we not express? There are things actually that we cannot express. We're going to talk about this in this conversation in the next year. There are actually boundaries. So anything that you can express within the realm of logic and mathematics can, as a rule of thumb, be implemented. Extremely intuitive stuff that has to do with experience, you can't. So, for example, if your program, if your optimization is based on determining what patterns of usage the input, patterns of input the user will give you, which keys will be pressed the most, which messages will come the most from the network, then you can't do that at the level of language. So there is a problem of context in some cases, or of complexity of the properties that you want to determine in code. That means that we can't always guarantee that we will get the absolute best of all these things. But we can still try. This is that's the fun of it. Because what we can't guarantee the best, but we can very surely approximate it. So the point is every language is an exercise in heuristically approximating a bunch of interesting properties, plus and trying to approximate as little as possible. So if we can just give the perfect answer, then we do it.
Does the perfect language exist?
No, it doesn't. Because every language is a different trade-off. We do clearly have a hierarchy of languages, if you want, for every axis. So you could say that in terms of performance, okay, this is very much my personal opinion, but you could say that here, probably in specific scenarios, SQL is the best optimizing language. If you know how to build indices in SQL, then it does amazing stuff. Seriously, you write no code, it becomes incredibly fast. Then you have C. Not very far. Then you have languages like I would dare say C sharp. Then you have Java, which is typically slightly slower than C sharp, at least in the domain of games. Then you have languages like OCaml. It really depends on how you write it. F sharp.
This is a functional language.
Functional languages do tend to be slightly slower if you write the functional version. Even though there are some optimizations that make, for example, Haskell jump here, if the language can activate them. So you see it is a trade-off. If it can see the pattern, if it can optimize the thing, if it can, I know, run in parallel, then it's here, otherwise it's kind of here. Then on the whiteboard there, we eventually find JavaScript. and Python, probably.
Python is love, Python is life.
Yeah, exactly. You know, probably if you have to do the knock-knock joke, who's there, and you wait and then say JavaScript, then you would probably have to work with next day. Which could actually be fun. We're going to start doing this. We're going to start now. No. Who's there?
And then just ignore for the JavaScript.
See you tomorrow. So basically, there are very good reasons why we would want to have programming languages. You could even realize that if you have, I don't know, in a company, business rules, okay, that require that you write lots of Java code that connects a bunch of widgets, then you could build a configuration language, which could even be complex enough to express lots of logic in it. And this is done by, for example, by CGI, where they have a large business rules logic engine that saves them a lot of work, because they don't want to make mistakes when it comes to money. And you could build something that automatically translates that into a working website, plus backend, plus, I don't know, credit card handling system, whatever, from a very short specification. So you could very well have a target language of Java itself. Okay? So languages can, or if you ever go work for a company that actually has to do stuff that is life and death important, then you would probably be interested in the correctness side. So performance matters, yeah, far less. Okay?
Can you divide it up? Language use of it, that it's always used for the user, so the user wants to do something that makes it easier for him, or makes the computer more accessible.
Yes. Anything you imagine can be done. You could build a visual language for teaching in the classroom. Whatever. So there are.
We should do that for the barn.
Endless possibilities. Yes, absolutely. That would be the idea. We can discuss that. So, I will introduce now a language which we call stands for imperative.
Okay.
So it's going to be a very typical, very simple programming language that more or less looks like the programming languages you know. So we'll define this, and this will be what you will be doing in the assignments. So you will actually build a whole compiler, parser, type checker, and compiler, or parser, type checker, and interpreter, or parser, type checker, interpreter, and then compiler of this language. Then we'll define a language that looks completely different, lambda calculus, just to show that languages do not have to all look the same. So this is a typical language that covers the semantic area, the style of languages like C, Java, C sharp, etc. This is going to be a language, they are both very small, very simple, that covers the core of languages like F sharp, Haskell, etc. Okay? Now, the imperative language. What are the things that we need in a language that looks like C? Okay, so primary data types. So int, bool,
insecure.
Okay, no. That is. Let's keep this as small as simple as possible.
Schrödinger's bool.
You know what? Int and bool. We will limit ourselves to ints and bools.
No characters.
Ints.
Just do ints and bool.
Yes, exactly.
You don't want a nightmare.
Yes. Then. What is, so these are the data types, okay, and these are actually keywords in the language, if you want. Then,
arrays.
Other
keywords?
Yes.
Class.
Oh, class, come on. Let's keep this simple.
Class.
Structures.
Class. Too complex. Simpler than that. Come on, what is the simplest thing that you need in the program?
Equal.
Sorry?
Equal sign.
Yeah, equal between what, 3 equals 7?
Yes.
Equal has a requirement. What is left hand side of equal? Left hand side of unequal?
Variables.
So var.
Which can be of type in the book.
Exactly. So we're going to say var name is has type t. Okay?
Wunderbar.
For example. We can very much choose whatever we want. We could say T name. And we want to go for slightly weird. We want to make it explicit that we are handling something that is different. Okay? Okay. Now, then the next one was?
The operators.
Operators? Okay, so we are going to go for.
Of a dollar?
What? Dollar operator.
Oh no, we can use the penis operator.
No, we can split it, the 8 equal and equal equal d, and they are separate operators that in some cases form a penis.
No, but then it should be...
And then the equal 8 operator, and sometimes you get 8 equal equal 8, which is weird. But no, we are not going to do that. Uh-oh. So, the operator you said before.
Equal.
Ah, what does... Equal is a sign that is typically used in Java, JavaScript, Python.
Double angle brackets.
No. What does that operator do?
Equal sign.
Assigns. So I'm going to have an assignment operator, and I do want to have another operator, mostly because equality is... I don't want our language to be able to support this. This kills me inside every time I see it. It's a bit of a Stockholm syndrome thing, which I still accept, but because it has to, but I do want to say this.
Oh, God.
Equal... Come on, it makes perfect sense. It's, you are defining x to be equal to x plus 1. Equality is Boolean equality.
Use arrows.
Oh, do you want the small arrow?
Yes, I do.
Who wants the small arrow?
Sure.
Okay. Ah, that's much sexier. Yes. Name, arrow, and here we'll have an expression, right?
Yeah, and then type keyword filler.
What?
Type is keyword filler.
And?
Type is keyword filler.
No, I'm not getting this.
Never mind.
Okay. Now, expressions. Now, what you were saying. Operators.
Equal.
Yes, equal. Okay, so we have expression equal, greater, smaller than, plus, minus, times,
not equal,
whatever, not equal, yes, all of these things. And what is on the other side?
A value.
Or another expression.
Why not another expression?
Because we're getting...
I mean, x is equal.
No, make it a retarded language. Left cannot be an expression and right only a boolean. You're gonna get so many errors. And you'll never know why.
Only on the lines of code that are multiples of 3.
Yeah, exactly. and then rotate it by 90 degrees ASCII.
No, but you can actually build an encoding that after 90/n, then it... changes the semantics so
dramatically. Or you do like Lata.
But we're not going to do that. Okay, so this is the very basics. What else do we have?
Nope, that's it.
Monads. Conditions? So, what do we need to express conditions?
If.
So else. If. Then else.
Elif.
No. Because we are able to nest. So we are building a very simple language. Then we could build syntactic sugar like L if that nests another if.
Oh, then we're also going to need all that.
What is the next thing we do? Absolutely need.
Me too.
Oh, we don't have functions. We're not going to bother.
A loop. Some sort of loop.
We need some sort of loop. Yes. I'm going to go for the simplest of all. Why? Why do you?
While still trying, continue assignment.
This is all we need to build a language that is very much a sort of assembly, a very simple imperative assembly, if you want. It's really simple. If we wanted to extend this to arrays, then actually we could. So we type array. We can actually. And that's it.
At least.
Nah. I know, fuck it, do this!
You want?
List
ain't
programming array using lists.
What? Again?
We can program an array using lists.
Oh, yes, of course. Well, we can program a list using an array.
A list shouldn't be that
much. Okay. You know what? We can go for the easy solution for the moment. No worries! If you need lots of stuff, then you declare lots of variables. Okay. So, what is more or less the syntax of this thing? More or less. Oh, come on.
Public void override.
So, let's go for something vintage, actually. First, the variable declarations, then the code. The semantics code that they want their language. So, we're going to have, first... So, I could say that a program is made up... Just way too long to write. So, a program P is made up of the variable declarations followed by the code. Okay? The variable declarations are one of these, followed by
a value.
So I'm going to say var name type. Here we have a type, followed by a semicolon if you want, yes. If you like semicolons, you get the semicolon. Then, followed by, how many variable declarations do we have?
As many as you want.
As many as we want, but here, if I write only this, then I'm saying that the program is one variable declaration followed by the code.
Followed by the code, or...
And the code is already in the program. I'm saying a program is variable declarations followed by the code, right? Does this make sense?
Followed by another variable declaration or the code.
Whoa, wait a second. So you're telling me that variable declaration is one variable declaration, specific, followed by
another one or the code.
The code is already here. Then I get the code twice. So, okay, I'm going to write this.
Followed by another one or not another one.
Or not another one. So, or nothing.
Yeah.
Okay? This is a symbol that means nothing. You see? So, if I need three variable declarations, I will use. In this case, how many times? There, say three. What? I need three variable declarations.
Yeah.
So I will do this three times, and then I'll finish up with this one.
Yes.
All right. Now, what is the code? So we have the variable declarations. Now, what is the what do we consider the code to be? We just literally have to transcribe these things. Is the code, well, can I just write here in the code somewhere just 3 greater than 5, just like this? Is this a reasonable line of code?
It will work.
It is.
What's it going to do? 3 greater than 5, semicolon, and then the rest.
Yes, it does not.
It does nothing. So at the code...
Well, you can write it. You need to have a variable and put an expression in it.
I guess if we have a way to put an expression in a variable,
yeah,
somewhere.
Hello.
We have the arrow, okay? So we have the arrow, but in the code, and this is the top level of code. Can we also have other stuff?
Yeah.
An if, okay, or? Or a loop. So, okay, so basically what we are telling me is that this, and this are allowed at the top level. Right? So, we say that the code is going to be, I'm going to call them statements. Statements because they state what has to happen. So they are orders. That is why it is an imperative language. Because it gives orders to, well, because you use it to give orders to the computer. Okay? And X becomes now 3 plus 5 is an order. You are saying, put the value 5 into x. It is literally an order, okay? Good. So it is a statement, S-T-M-T, followed by what? So a statement we said is one of these, or one of these. Followed by?
An expression.
Why do I have to put an expression? So I have
another statement or an expression.
By another statement or an expression?
Or nothing.
Oh. So we have surely an or nothing, because at some point the program has to end. After the statement, what do we have?
Another statement, or an expression, or nothing.
I'm going to put a semicolon here for the cleanliness, if you want. You said another statement, just one.
Maybe.
Code. I like that.
No.
Why not?
Because code can only contain statements.
So basically, code becomes a bunch of statements.
Yes.
Separated by semicolon.
But then you don't have the expression.
I haven't defined the statement yet.
Okay.
Now let's define the statements.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I'm not kidding. So now, I will ask you to take 5 minutes, get in pairs. This was the reason why we had paper. Try to define the statements. You know that the statements are this one, and this one. Alright? Have fun. Have 5 minutes.
Recording. Ja, een beetje voor mij.
Deel
2. Deel 2. Act 2. We continue, continue.
Come closer.
No.
No, you can't.
The last one you pick up is the one you're using.
Technology.
You can pick up the visor and then use the pen. That's the reason. Yeah,
just use your fingers. Okay, now. We were.
I think you've done great.
Oh, well done.
We were defining the imp language. So what we have in the imp language is a bunch of things which are variables, basic types, expressions, and statements. So do you remember what was, given an imp program, what is it made of?
The variable declarations. And the code.
Variable declarations, yes. Followed by?
The code.
The code, yes. Code. Actually, I'm going to use...
Statements.
Yes, exactly. I'm going to use a better name for that, which is?
Statements.
Why?
Code is made up of statements.
Because the code is made up of a sequence of statements, yes. So, STMDS. Okay? Now, variable declarations are
variables with
sorry?
Variables with the types. what types they are.
Yes.
And
a name.
The dictionary of that declaration.
Okay, so pick a syntax.
Var, name, type.
No, okay, so we are going to go with this. Var, I'm going to put quotes around it because I literally do expect there. Var. V-A-R. Then the name. This is going to be an identifier. Then?
The type.
So we have
T.
Some symbol to signify that we have a separation. Then the type, yes. I'm actually going to write type. Then do we want an initial value?
It's possible.
Okay, I do like it. So equals. And then?
12.
Expression.
An expression. And then an expression. Okay? Now, this is a single variable declaration. So, the variable, but BD is the variable declarations. So, all variable declarations. So, what follows a single variable declaration?
BD,
yes. So, semicolon BD.
Or.
Or nothing, okay? So, we have seen this structure, this kind of data structure already. What is this?
Forget the ONS.
Not really. What kind of data structure is this?
A parsed keyword.
No, it isn't. It contains a parsed keyword.
This.
Sorry?
A list.
Why would it be a list?
Because it has points to the next...
How is the list defined?
You have a head, and the tail is basically the rest of the...
What is the head here?
Var ID type.
Equal expression, yes?
Basically.
Yes. What is the name of the constructor of a non-empty list?
Empty.
No, of a non-empty list. How do we call here a non-empty list? It actually does have a name.
Fili.
Sorry?
Fili.
No, that is the name of the list data structure.
The dot comma.
The semicolon.
That's a creator.
The semicolon is, yes, the semicolon is literally the name of this thing. So you could say that the semicolon has this on the left, this is the head of the list.
The left argument.
And on the right, we have the right argument, which is the rest of the list. Okay, the tail.
Which
okay.
Will go on in the same manner.
Yes, exactly. Or the whole list can be empty. What do we call empty in F sharp?
No.
Sorry?
Two square brackets.
The two square brackets. Okay. Now, let's go for the type, for example. What is the type? We are going with very simple basic types. What kind of types do we accept?
Integer.
Int? Okay.
Boolean.
So?
Int and boolean.
Int or bool?
C.
That's it.
Now, let's move on. I'm going to try something technologically very advanced now.
Yeah, that works.
It actually works better than the rest.
Yeah.
That's the only thing that actually works.
It actually really works, yes. Okay, so now let's expand what an expression is.
No.
Even though we might want a print statement somewhere, but that is a statement, not an expression. An expression is something you evaluate, and a statement is an order that you give to the machine. So print is an order. Now, an expression. Make me an example of an expression.
3 plus 5,
yes.
Or A plus B.
Or A plus B.
But they have different handling. We have to evaluate
that. Why would we not accept A plus B?
Because it's on the integer.
If A is an integer variable?
It is, it actually is correct. It is an expression, but you have to...
make sure that A and B are declared.
Integers.
Yes. But that is the job for? The type checker. Okay, so an expression to be plus, it's plus between what?
Two expressions.
Two types.
Because an expression can be a value and or another expression. But in the end it will return a value.
So wait a second, you just said value. I'm actually going to say an expression is a value or
another expression.
Ah, it's a very circular definition.
Yeah, so that's good.
Right, an expression is either a value, okay, or
another expression.
Yeah, with a specific form.
Expression.
For example, expression plus expression.
Ah, yeah, right.
So, expression plus expression.
And that will go on until you.
And that will go on. Actually, to make my life slightly simpler.
Just declare the operator.
Exactly. I'm going to say expression
op
expression.
And then you can define all the operators.
And then we define op. Can you make me examples of op?
Plus times. Yes, a smiley face.
Smiley face operator. Square.
You can have fun in the assignment. Plus, minus, greater than.
Smaller than.
But only the operators.
And
integer
or. Equal,
divide,
scale, times, divide, etc. Okay? All of these. You could even have plus times that, I don't know, adds the values and multiplies by the second. Whatever. So, yeah, absolutely. The sky is the limit.
Not really. Logic is the limit.
Yeah. So, and this is our way. So far, we have defined everything that has to do with composing variables and expressions. So we could even declare in the variable declarations that variable x is equal to y plus 3, referring to y, which is a previous variable. Okay?
Ooh.
Now,
wait a second.
Oops.
The statement. What are the statements? How many statements do we have in a program?
Also be infinite.
Infinite statements in a program?
No, there's a hard limit.
Depends on how long you make
the program. Somewhere
over there.
Yeah,
three, right?
That's your answer.
Infinite is one thing. So infinite means that you can give a program with infinite statements.
Yes.
It's going to take a lot of time to write it.
Yes, but it's good.
Is it infinite? Any program, if I give you a program, then it has a finite amount of statements. But how many? No, not potentially infinite.
Depends on your hard drive.
All the possible combinations.
So if I say maximum number of statements, well, is there a maximum number of statements?
Probably.
Like 42? 100? 10,000?
Yes.
Oh, why probably? It depends on the machine. You buy a bigger machine.
Well, it has to end somewhere eventually.
So, it is a finite amount of statements.
But quite big.
But
you don't know how big it is.
But we don't know how big. Okay? So, please do learn the difference between infinite and
finite,
but we don't know how long. Okay, so it is a finite, but we don't know how long sequence of things. Can it also be empty?
If you don't write anything,
hello world.
No, not even hello. Hello world would be a statement.
Yeah. That would be the
so the return zero program. So I'm going to start actually with we can have an empty sequence of statements. I guess if it's going to come out as something that we have just seen. So the statements are empty or
non-empty.
Non-empty. And non-empty means?
Finite. But we don't know how long it is.
If it is non-empty, how many does it have at least?
At least one.
At least one.
One or more.
So it is at least one statement and others.
One and one more or nothing.
So one statement.
So the same as expression.
So the same as list.
So the same as?
List.
Yeah, it's basically a list of.
So the same.
It's a list of statements.
Ooh. Where do we have something that looks like a list here?
Variable declarations.
I hear variable declarations, which sounds like a good answer. So, come on. What are the statements going to look like then?
Scroll.
Oh, come on.
Well, like a list.
Like a list. So,
a
statement.
Yeah.
Followed by
a rest of a statement.
Empty or a list.
A semicolon.
And then again, statement.
And then again,
statement.
Do I need an S here or not?
Yes.
No. Yeah. Yes, because it is intrinsically the.
So you say just one statement followed by a list of statements.
And as soon as it's empty, it will suspend itself.
And as soon as it's empty, suspend. It's just done. What do we do now? It looks
like. No,
no.
At the bottom.
There
is
the middle.
No,
In multiple ways. There's infinite ways to give a grammar typically. But the reason why I'm doing this is for, if you want software engineering reasons, I'm trying to encapsulate every definition so that it does one and only one thing.
And otherwise recurs.
Otherwise there's lots of repetition. Now what is the simplest statement of all?
Expression.
Sorry?
Equal.
Equal?
No, just simpler. There's nothing.
No. We always want a statement to be full, to do something, because we can have an empty list of statements. Just an empty statement at this point is pointless.
Okay.
What do you mean?
Just declare a variable.
No, variable declaration is only done at the top of the program.
Oh. Assign a variable.
Assign a variable. Okay. So a statement is ID, the name of the variable. Hopefully it's the name of a correctly declared variable with the proper type, but we are not caring now.
And then we add an expression to it.
Sorry.
We went for the little arrow.
Oh. Oh no, we went for the arrow. Yes. ID.
To,
arrow.
Expression.
And then?
Expression.
Or? This is another statement.
ID arrow value?
No.
Oh no, value is an expression arrow value.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, did we say that? Sorry.
Yes, we did.
Oh yes, but we haven't clarified what the value is, so we'll have to do that later. So come on, another statement.
An if statement?
An if statement, okay. So, if, then what do we have here?
An expression.
Then?
Less statement.
Then?
Less statements.
Less of statements.
Oh no, condition first. We need a condition.
No, that's
the expression.
Oh, for fuck's sake. Oh, yeah. Then
so?
Less of statements.
Less of statements.
So, how do I call it?
STMTS?
Yes. Statements?
Sounds like a disease.
Yeah.
Then, else? Statements. Oh! So, this means that I could I have an if within an if?
Yes, you can.
How?
Because the statement is also an if.
So, if I have the statements of the program, the first statement could be an if, and the statements, the first one, could be an if.
Yes.
No.
Never until infinity. We always stop at some point. But we don't know how far.
No,
okay?
While.
And then the why?
Well, x.
Why? X.
Do.
Statements.
Do statements.
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 The very last bit we were almost forgetting is what is a value?
A value can be a boolean or an integer.
So a value is a boolean const.
Or an integer const.
Or an int const. Now for the moment let's assume that we have already like a library defined that is capable of handling bool const and int const. It doesn't seem to be that interesting.
So I think we have to declare all the
But. So it means that I can build an expression like 3, or 3 plus 5, or 3 plus 2. But what if I also wanted to be able to write x times 2?
Then you need an expression
type again.
No.
X is...
How do we denote a variable?
By evaluating it.
Look at statement, the first line of statement.
So we need the ID.
ID.
You know what an ID is? It's an identifier of a variable. So it's,
and
it's
it points to the value.
Yes. So, what is a value then?
Pointed.
If I also want to include variables.
Then you need to point to ID.
Point to ID?
Yes, you need a pointer.
You just need an ID.
Yeah.
If you talk about a pointer, then you're talking about how it's going to be implemented.
Yeah, alright, okay.
But we don't know. We haven't given a semantic yet. The semantic of this language might be you ignore everything, you print hello world. Why not? Who says?
Would be fun though.
Very much. Yes, absolutely. Or it could be if you declare an even number of variables, then it only prints hello world.
We're going to make the least user-friendly programming language in the world.
Oh, I think you
can only multiply integers by booleans.
Okay.
You have true, false, and it's 2 to the power of 3.
So, now, at this point, what we will still need to do to define this language is define what are valid expressions and valid statements. So, for example, in terms of types,
We need restrictions.
So restrictions, we'll see how we can express that more structurally. But what restrictions would we want? Describe that in words.
You wouldn't want to multiply an integer with a boolean.
Okay. So we have.
So we need to define the restrictions of the operator. We have to specify what the left arguments are and the right arguments.
Yes, exactly. So for every one of those operators, you might want to say, what is the type
of the left and right
argument. Of the left and right argument, and what is the type of the whole thing?
Yeah.
So you could say, plus can only work if the type on the left is an integer, the type on the right is an integer, and the result is an integer. And what do you use the result for? To check if this expression is used in the right place. Because you could have 3 plus 5 plus 2.
Build the syntax tree and you can see.
Yes. So, so plus 3 x 2. What would this look like? In code, what would this look like?
3 plus x plus 5.
3 plus
2.
X plus 2. Brackets where?
Three plus x.
Okay. So we want to make sure that this whole thing makes sense, right? So we see it's a plus, the first one, and this plus will return a plus, provided that this is an int. Sorry, this plus will return an int, provided that this is an int and this is an int, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
you evaluate
A plus B will return, will have type int
infinity.
Or actually no, you know what? Because I do like that syntax more. Which someone may recognize. So A plus B is going to return an int given that, what does A have to return?
A.
An int.
And B has to return an int.
And B has to return an int.
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
Okay.
So, if you now write eval A.
So, I'm not talking about how plus evaluates, but I'm saying if A returns an int and B returns an int, then A plus B will return an int. I'm not providing any other rules, any other information about plus. So this is the only way to solve plus. Okay? Now...
This is kind of close to inference systems. Like, kind of like...
Really? Does it look like inference systems?
A little bit, yeah.
I don't think so. Exactly.
Yeah.
Now, other stuff I could say is that 0, for example, will always return what?
X.
Integer. 0.
I heard the right answer.
Integer.
Yeah. No. It always returns an integer. The same goes for 1, 2,
Aha,
3.
No, this is not the way to do that.
Oh, come on, shut up. So, an integer constant. An integer constant is always going to return what? An integer. What if I have a variable?
Try something.
S of z. S of z.
Yeah, this is only forgivable because of what you've just been through. In the last couple of hours.
Okay, good.
So, you have the feeling you would have in a room full of puppies that have just been beaten. So that's the only reason why. Now, what if I have a variable, x? Hi. What if this is a variable? What is the type of the variable?
Unknown.
We don't know. It's the type of
the
ID.
You give us an ID.
Yes, but when was that given?
Top of the code.
Tell you.
At the beginning of the program.
Variable.
All the variable declarations, exactly. So, we should need to carry with us, we can't just say X from the ID determine the type. So we also need something like a storage of types of variables. I'm going to call it, well, a typical name is gamma. Yeah, sorry. But, no, it is a typical name, yes. But we are going to use G for, no. You know what, these are the declarations, right? So we want to carry the declarations, D. Okay? So, what is the type of x, of variable x? We look into the declarations. So, whatever x was is known to D. So we say D of x. Right? So if you want to determine the declaration, the type of a variable, you go look into the declarations D, and you say, this variable with this name, with this ID, what was its type? Alright? You go to the variable declarations, you have declared them at the beginning of the program. As you go through them, you accumulate. You have var x double point int. So you say, you build a dictionary, x goes to int.
That will be the symbol table, right?
That is literally the symbol table, yes. And so D, after you process the first bit of the language, you'll have something like D is equal to x is int, y is int, z is bool. You see? And these correspond to what declarations? Var x double point int, var y double point int, var z double point bool. Okay?
But the operator is in simple table as well, right?
No, we don't care about the operators. The operators are pretty fine. There's lag.
Yeah, quite a bit.
It's no lag, you just suck.
Yeah, right.
That's what everyone says.
Okay, so this means that also all of these rules here would actually need to be extended because we have to carry the D around.
Wow. Where else
would you put it?
Exactly. You can't leave it home, right?
Well, where do you want to put it?
In the X stuff.
So, now in most cases, the D is not going to be used. Now you're reading stuff in
there. Why not?
But you can't use the D and in an appropriate moment. So you see, if you want to know the type of A plus B, you want to know the type of A and B. But what is A and what is B? It could be that A and B are expressions. It could be that A and B are constants, so you do not you need to use, you have no variables, so that D is not used. But if A is a variable, then you actually need to carry the D around until you get the variable. So
that works as well.
Yes, and also it's not what we want. It's like a joke, you know, they put buttons. I'm not going to touch anything. No. Oh, and now it's not. Oh.
You can
No, it does not work.
No, it's a glitch in the system.
Okay, anyway. So the point is, we carry information about the types of world variables in case, so we carry it around, see, we are giving it through. In some cases, we get to the point where we have the information already, so it was not needed. In some cases, we get to the point where we actually needed it. So we have to carry it around for the case, in case we are going to need it later. Now, if we have something like the if, we're going to have to check if the condition is a Boolean, and both, and that's basically all we do for the if, and for the while, same. But we'll see that better. In the coming lecture. Okay. Now, let's discuss what's going to happen if we decide to execute a program in the imperative language. So, how do we describe execution? So, we have parsed the thing according to the grammar, somehow. We have type check, yeah, that's the topic of the next lecture.
Depends on what we're building.
No, but let's assume that we want to go for a very simple, basic, intuitive semantic.
You want to rebuild it in the same language, or you want to use another target language?
I want to use the same these sort of rules to define how the program is going to behave. So it is an independent formulation, if you want. A language-independent formulation. I want to formulate it as much as possible within a mathematical narrow.
So transform.
So I want to say program P goes into some result res. Okay. Right. This is what I want to define. I want to say how the program P computes, transforms into, you have to imagine that the arrow is a very literal transformation arrow, so you follow it from
then we need to know what
left to right. Sorry?
Then we need to cover all the possibilities of what.
Then we need to cover all the possibilities of how the program is built.
So what it will consist of?
Yes, exactly. But we know already what the program looks like, because what does the program look like? Yes, but you should remember it, come on.
Yeah, plus times we have already.
No. The program.
Variable declarations.
Variable declarations.
Statements.
Followed by statements. So, we know that our program.
Doesn't work.
Oh. So, we know that when we run it, we actually have variable declarations followed by statements. And actually, I don't even need to give the same name as before. I can just call it whatever that I want. I know that I have the variable declaration and the statements, and I want to find the result.
R, okay?
So we have to evaluate this.
Wait a second. First of all, what do you expect is the result going to be?
Integer or digit? Or void?
What is the result of the execution of a problem?
A state.
He says a state.
State of memory.
All the variables that were.
All the variables might be a very reasonable answer. So we just give back whatever was computed. It's a problem of the interpreter or the user to determine whatever they want to do with them. It might be that the interpreter, if we have an interpreter, just prints out whatever variable is named output. Doesn't matter. That's a problem of how it's implemented, right? So we say we want to push out the final state of all the variables. What is the part of a modern computer where all the variables are stored?
Memory.
What do you think?
This.
I didn't catch it.
What is the part of a modern computer where all variables are stored?
Memory.
Yes. So, what is a better name for R?
We go for mem.
Let's go. Let's assume that I'm extremely lazy. So we have variables, statements, go into memory. Makes sense. Now, do we have an initial memory? Well, the initial memory, what's in it? So in the initial memory we have the V. So we will have something like, from the initial V, we build, no, the initial memory. Then, we have the initial memory, we have the statements, what do we do with it? We execute it. So, I'm going to use another symbol for execution. The execution of the statements, or not even, no, you know what, I'm still going to use arrows, they're prettier. So, S, N, M, 0, go into M. So, roughly, what would you say this is? What is the first step?
Loading the variables.
He says loading the variables, yes.
Running the statements.
No, wait a second. The first step. V goes into M0. He says loading the variables, which makes sense. Also,
because you have to get your begin state. Right?
Yes, so we build the begin state.
Which will be M0.
Which will be M0. So we also call this process initialization, for example, startup, etc. Okay, so we are initializing our system. Loading the variables. So these are all proper names. So, but what is, what does V look like? Sorry? V.
Hi.
The variables. What does it look like? We have it in the grammar above. So, but this, when we run this, we'll have either, well, first of all, what's the simplest case of variables? Oh, sorry.
That we don't load shit.
You know what? I'm also going to simplify my life. It's going to be hopefully clear why. I'm going to say V and the empty memory, and I use square brackets, goes into M0. I actually give it the initial memory. So this way I'm starting up memory as empty. So what is V going to look like then? What, the simplest case.
Empty.
So if I have empty no variable declarations, and
M0 is going to be empty.
Empty declarations, and some memory M. What is the resulting memory?
Empty memory M.
It is certainly not empty. I mean, if I get to the last one, I just ignore the previous.
Memory M.
It's the whole M. So whatever I got so far, because this doesn't mean that V here was empty. It means that we have gotten to empty. So this is M.
T.
The other case that we might find is that the memory was not empty. If it isn't, sorry, that the variable declarations were not empty. Not empty variable declarations, what does it look like?
Students.
Yes? Var?
Var name.
Name? X?
Type.
Has type T? Equals an expression, right? Okay, then what do we have? Semicolon,
the
rest of the variable declarations, yes. Then we have the memory so far. So basically, what is this going to look like? What if I wanted to move this above?
You can use the pointer. Yeah, and then
you
select
it.
So, what do I have to do with respect to this variable declaration here? I have the memory M, which contains what?
Other declarations.
Other declarations, the one found so far. So, what's going to happen to memory? What do we have to do with memory? We found a variable declaration.
You add new one to the end.
Shall I add it?
Yeah.
To the M?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So, but what value are we going to put in X?
The evaluation of expression E.
Oh?
Expression E.
If I have X as type T is equal to E, so something like X as type int is equal to 3 plus 5, what will the value of X be? No, it is not going to be 3 plus 5. 3 plus 5 is an expression.
It's going to be 8.
It's going to be?
8.
It's going to be 8.
35.
Does it make sense? If you say X as type T and it's going to be equal to 3 plus 5, what do you expect is going to happen to memory? We'll have X connected to type.
So you are going to
8.
You are going to apply eval E to the memory.
I will eval E to memory.
And yeah, memory.
M. What do I get?
In M.
Do I? Does the evaluation of an expression change memory?
No, per se, but it might.
It might.
Do we want it?
Depends. Do we want?
Shall we keep things simple?
Okay. Then it doesn't change. It.
Yes, so we only get a result. Y.
Okay. But then we have to assign I.
Then Y is either a number or a boolean, but it is a value.
So we have to apply it to X in memory.
So I have to apply it to X in memory, connect it to X in memory.
Yes.
So M1 is going to be M with... No, I don't like it. M1 is going to be M. I'm just going to write it out where X is connected to Y. It's not equal, it's connected, it goes to.
Yeah.
You could say X is equal to Y.
And then we have to call the function again with the rest of the list of expressions.
Because, not of expressions.
Yeah, the list of statements.
V with
the
M.
The list of?
V with M1.
V with M1, yes.
And V contains a list of?
Declarations.
Of declarations, because we have to add the rest of the declarations to memory.
Yeah.
So, V, comma?
M1.
Why M1?
Because that's the updated memory.
Because that's the updated memory. If I use M, what's going
to
happen?
Nothing is going to be stored.
Nothing is going to be stored. I'm ignoring whatever work I have done so far. So V, M1, goes into...
The same function again.
I have no idea.
Res.
Res, or M final.
And so the entire expression rule returns M final.
What do we find in M final?
State of the memory after everything has been updated. The entire declarations have been processed in memory.
The entire declarations from var x and all the following.
Yes.
But perhaps there are others above, because it might not be that this is the first case. It might be that this is the fourth variable. So then var m final will be given back, and your stuff is going to be added to
but
it.
But we are missing the base case. Oh, sorry, no, we're not.
M final. Oh. Okay. Now, you all look quite suffering at this point.
No, I feel fine. Go on.
So, at the beginning of the next lecture, I will give you a few. Oh, you can turn it off. The camera. We're done.
How do you turn it off?